Thank you. So I'll be speaking about critical infrastructure and presenting a case study on cyber threats to nuclear facilities because I've just finished a report on the topic. But much of what I am going to talk about is generalizable beyond the sector, of course. So some quick background. The immediate threat is to the power grid, which is very vulnerable. So nuclear facilities, in contrast, are much more secure. But the reason that we chose to focus on nuclear facilities in this instance was because even though it would be extremely difficult to do, we were concerned about the potential for a cyber attack to result in the release of radiation. The 2010 discovery of the Stuxnet worm as well, which was designed by the US and Israel to sabotage Iranian nuclear facilities.
Allegedly.
Allegedly, thank you. Good point. was also a factor, in terms of making us think about the need to investigate actually what, you know, how vulnerable are cyber, how vulnerable are nuclear facilities. And as part of this project, I did interviews with 30 different people, a mix of nuclear facility operators, IT practitioners, policymakers, academics, and held 3 roundtable meetings at Chatham House. So some trends that can be observed. It's becoming increasingly easy to carry out cyber attacks, or it's becoming easier. We have the increased availability of freely available automated exploit toolkits. So for example, the Metasploit framework enables users to use and execute any exploit combined with any payload. So it was designed to automate the process of penetration testing, but hackers can now use these same exploits by simply replacing the payload with a malicious one. Then we have the growth of search engines like Shodan, which allows you to search for critical infrastructure that's connected to the internet. And then once you find an internet-connected system, you might be able to take advantage of a default password to gain access. And many nuclear facilities do not change default passwords on their equipment. So if you know that for Honeywell or Siemens, the default password is, say, 1234, then you'll be able to get in. Fabio mentioned already markets for zero-day vulnerabilities. Next trend, our critical infrastructure is in some ways becoming much more vulnerable as well. So nuclear facilities and, of course, other types of critical infrastructure are increasingly adopting systems that have more digital features, using commercial off-the-shelf software, which is easier to hack because of the cost savings that they provide. And for these same reasons, they are also increasingly connecting to the internet. And many nuclear facilities now have some form of internet connectivity. So this has come about, there's a number of third parties that are located off-site that are going to need access to data generated by the plant. And you'll have the head office, you'll probably, you might have, government certs or other crisis response bodies. They're going to need data fast, and they're going to need a lot of data, and the internet is just the easiest way to do that. Now, there's also increased lobbying pressure from vendors who want to be able to provide remote monitoring of their equipment. So some plants, for example, are permitting vendors to access facilities remotely through a VPN connection, a virtual private network. But if your VPN is not secure, you may have a point of entry for the hacker. So a key point, I'm trying to talk fast, many plants do not realize the extent of their internet connectivity. So one big problem as well is undocumented connections, and those might sometimes be set up by contractors. So for example, even though wireless connections wouldn't be strictly forbidden in nuclear facilities, a contractor might, for reasons of convenience, install a wireless network in the office and not tell systems administrators that he or she has done this. There's also forgotten connections, so the contractor might intend to remove it later and then just simply forget to do so. So one key finding is that since the industry is currently undergoing evolution, the nuclear industry may not fully understand the risk. So in doing interviews with people, many of the people in the industry that I talked to were convinced that all nuclear plants are air-gapped, so completely separated from the public internet. And then a number of people also believe that if they are air-gapped, that protects them from a cyber attack. And I mean, it does help, of course. But the fact is that nuclear facilities are always going to have a need to either download data, for example, to get data off the plant, or maybe less frequently to upload data for example, if you're doing a software upgrade, so, and you know, you will have to breach the air gap, you'll need a flash drive or you'll need something. So, you know, I mean, Stuxnet showed us that an air gap is no guarantee. Next point. And I think another issue is limited incident disclosure, which makes it difficult to assess the true extent of the problem because we haven't had that many incidents that have been disclosed. So I think there's this sense that there have been very few incidents, and that reinforces the belief that cybersecurity is not a threat. And you know, we have all kinds of knock-on effects because you know, because we've underestimated the risk, there's not enough investment in cybersecurity. Next point as well that came up is that developing countries are obviously particularly at risk because some countries are just starting to learn and you know, about cybersecurity. They have even fewer resources to invest. And you know, moreover, they might not speak English very well or at all. And because so much of the body of knowledge is in English, it's gonna make it a lot harder for them to learn about best practices. So then there's a section on cultural challenges. So I think we know that OT and IT sometimes have a tense relationship. So nuclear plant personnel, those are going to be OT or operational technology engineers, whereas the cybersecurity personnel are going to be IT engineers. And they have very different priorities and different ways of thinking. So quick explanation is just IT is, you know, the operations of the plant, the industrial control systems, and then IT is concerned with computers and networks. And so these differences in plants often lead to frictions and clashes. So one example is, so OT, their main priority is always going to be safety, whereas for IT, their priority is always going to be security. So one person I interviewed was talking about a meeting in which the OT engineers wanted the IT engineers to add security, but they were telling the IT engineers, well, we've done 19 safety tests, you're the last test, test 20, and that's the security test, and just make sure you don't invalidate any of the previous tests, just add on, you know, just add on the security. And so, you know, apparently the meeting was very frustrating and, you know, the IT engineers were trying to explain it's just not possible because, you know, we will make changes that are going to invalidate some of the previous safety tests. And then you have the issue of availability versus security as well. So for OT engineers, their main priority is availability, so uptime of the plant, whereas for IT, obviously, it's security. So that might mean that in order to maintain security, the IT engineers might want a shutdown of the plant to eliminate a cybersecurity threat, maybe to install a patch, which is going to be a huge conflict with the OT engineers and their priorities. So what this means, like at the plant level, is there's a major impact, like these differences of opinion in ways of seeing things in terms of how things happen at the facility. So the IT engineers have developed the cybersecurity procedure documents that the OT engineers need to understand and implement. And so the OT engineers, or the nuclear plant personnel, they report not understanding the cybersecurity procedures at all, that they're poorly written, but also just very unclear. And so, for example, the procedures might say, in the event of a cybersecurity incident, stop what you're doing, don't touch industrial control systems, don't touch any critical systems, call IT, and here's an organigram. So that should actually be kind of simple, although maybe it's a bit condescending, but that's a different story. But actually, they say the organigram is so confusing that they actually don't even know who within the IT team to call. Because that was another issue coming out as well, is obviously the IT, they're not going to be on site. They might be 100 miles away. And they don't actually come out to the plant all that much. And so the communication problems that you have are going to be exacerbated. Okay, I'm totally out of time. All right, cybersecurity training at nuclear facilities, that was actually coming back quite quickly in that it's often insufficient, and you know, maybe people who don't really know a lot are doing the training. Final point, all of these communication problems and insufficient training, all of that suggests that nuclear plants might lack preparedness for a large-scale cybersecurity emergency, particularly if one were to occur in the middle of the night. Sorry, I went 20 or 30 seconds over.
And you're not done, you have predictions.
You're right, okay, really quickly. My predictions are not concerning nuclear facilities, but on critical infrastructure. Number one, we will have a major successful attack on the power grid that will take down significant parts of a country for at least a day, and that'll be reported in the media. And two, this is a bit edgier, but a terrorist group like ISIS teams up with a private hacker for hire company to successfully attack the power grid or maybe other critical infrastructure like, you know, sewage plants or. I don't think that they can do really massive damage. You know, I think it would be more of media hype, so I think it would be a smaller effect, but I think the media effect would be quite large.